We have a guest today, everybody.
I know.
Yes.
What a rare treat.
You guys know that's so rare for us, but we are super excited to talk to our guest today, Yeardley Smith.
Yes.
Hi, Yeardley.
Hi.
Hi.
Oh, man.
I'm so happy to be here. Thank you.
You guys recognize that voice. I mean, right away.
Of course.
Right away. And I'm sure you get that a lot.
I do. It's unmistakable. This is me. This is Lisa Simpson. It's just not that far apart.
Yeah. See, I've wondered because, like, you know, I've got kids and the kids watch all these cartoons and I'm like, man, nobody naturally sounds that way. Uh-huh. You know, so I'm like, man, it's got to be a pretty cool gig, you know, coming up. Like, how do you come up with the voice? And so, like, the voice of Lisa Simpson. Did you just go in? I mean, because the story was that you were doing theater or something, right?
That's true. Still the story.
Yeah.
It hasn't changed.
No, sticking with it.
I'm always fascinated by like how something, I mean, because obviously nobody knew The Simpsons would be what The Simpsons became and what
later.
The Simpsons are.
That's right.
You know, so you're doing this theater show and that's where the person said, hey, you should be part of this for the Tracy Ullman show.
Yes, that's the bare bones of the story. I'm sticking to it. I was doing a tiny little play at a tiny little theater in Los Angeles, and about 17 people saw that play, and one of them, a year later, was casting The Simpsons on the Tracy Ullman show and said, I know who should play Lisa Simpson.
Really?
Meanwhile, wow. I was brought in to read for Bart.
Yeah.
But I don't think it was because they thought, oh, she'd be great for Bart. I think it's because women owe us to the voices of young boys because our voices don't change.
Mm-hmm.
And so it was just like, let's just throw the spaghetti at the wall. But it and really, my audition for Bart lasted about 7 seconds.
Yeah, but when you went in, and did you go in there with the, like, okay, so we're going to do this cartoon. Did they give you anything to work with?
They gave me a very rough sketch, and I can't remember if they explained that they would be what we called bumpers on the Tracy Ullman show. So
yeah.
We told a whole story in 1 minute in 20-second segments, and those segments would air before the commercial break. It had never been done before, not like that. And so I remember thinking, great, the job is what? You want me to what? And, you know, voiceover was not part of my plan for world domination at all, and I did have a plan for world domination. Voiceover was not on that list.
What
I didn't
was
even
it?
Have a voiceover agent.
So what was your plan?
You know, the plan, I would say, actually, I misspeak, because it wasn't so much of a plan as it was a vision that I would win all of the awards, that I would be an EGOT at a very, very young age. You know, I had no shame. I was rapaciously ambitious. Still am, although I'm a little more polite about it than I was back then. And, but I think because I was teased for my voice when I was a kid, I didn't think that voiceover could possibly amount to anything really positive. I wasn't. And so, but really, who has the last laugh now?
I was going to say,
exactly.
People, all those people want your autograph. And I guarantee all those people that were making fun of you at that time are going like, oh, you know.
I knew her all along. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Oh, no, I knew her. We were friends.
We were best friends.
Yeah.
Absolutely best friends.
No, but it's really cool, man. Because, I mean, you know, for what that's become. In fact, The Simpsons, the storyboarding and everything for The Simpsons happens in this building.
Yeah.
Isn't that amazing?
That we have because we have a lot of people that listen to our show. Who are fans of our show, and then we found and met them and found out what they did, we were so fascinated by
what?
It's so fascinating.
Yeah, it's really cool.
I really consider myself 33 1/3% of the creation and why people love Lisa Simpson, because it starts with the writing, and then it goes to us, the actors, and then the animators interpret what they hear on the track that's delivered to them.
Okay, see, that was my question, because I wondered, you know, do you have the ability to do any kind of, like, ad-libbing while you're voicing these characters and adding a little something that maybe wasn't even in the script? You know, that's big when you have, like, live action movies.
Yes, there's lots of ad-libbing. We are hamstrung by our 22-minute, how long we have to make an episode, right?
Yeah.
22 minutes for an episode. So sometimes a lot of the ad-libbing doesn't get in, but I feel like that's not even as important as the fact that kind of interaction, because we record all together like an old radio play.
Oh, nice. Oh,
that's cool.
It gives the show a texture, and obviously the way you say something, Woody, is going to inform the way I respond.
Mm-hmm.
So
yeah.
While at this point I could certainly do the character in a vacuum, and when I do my pickups, when I do ADR, we go back and re-record dialogue, and they've rewritten a joke, and the animation's already been done. We do a lot of that as well. But its inception is because starts with all of us in the same room and having a conversation like you would on any sitcom.
That's awesome.
And that's cool. I figured you were all in different places.
Yeah, you did it at
different times.
It's very rare. I don't know any other animated show that does it the way we do. But James L. Brooks, who's our executive producer, he, of course, Taxi, Mary Tyler Moore, He's a legend. And when we went to half hour as The Simpsons, and even before when we were doing it on the Tracy Ullman show, he said, I don't know why this is any different than being a live action television show. Of course, you should all be in the same room. So that's how it started.
Yeah. So Yeardley Smith is here. We've been talking about The Simpsons. She is the voice. She is Lisa Simpson.
Yeah. Yep.
Which is interesting, you know, because you watch people who are actors. I've been on the set of like a friend of mine works on a TV show invited that I like, Silicon Valley. So I went down and I watched a taping, you know, watched them film for a day. And it took all day long because you have to move all the cameras around, do the different angles.
It
but
takes
when you're
forever.
Doing the animation, like how long does it take from beginning to end to for you, like you're part of the job, like because everybody's together reading, like you said.
Yes.
So to do for the actors,
for us,
start to finish.
It's very light. So we have a table read where the actors get together in a conference room with the writers. On a Thursday morning, that takes 45 minutes. It's the first time the writers hear the script out loud. Based on the reaction that they get and what jokes they feel work and what don't, they go back and rewrite that for a week and a half. And then we record that episode the following Monday. So the week Monday, right?
Okay. Mm-hmm.
And that process, because it's such a well-oiled machine now, takes 4 to 5 hours.
Wow.
So ours is very, very small. We touch the episode very lightly compared to everybody else. It takes 8 or 9 months to animate one episode.
Yeah.
It's so labor intensive for the back end and also for the writers, you know. And so we have a massive writing staff, 24 writers, which is huge for a half hour show. But they have two writers' rooms going. And when we're fully into production, like we just started recording season 31. Which is a phrase I never thought I would say.
Unbelievable.
Well, it got renewed for 31 and 32.
It did. So grateful. And so I was going to say something snarky, but
Please. We love snarky.
So grateful. It means
we thrive on snarky.
Yeah.
I can continue to blow the nest egg. No. So the animators, the writers are working on shows that are coming back in various stages of animation, as well as generating new scripts. So they really never get a break. We our hiatus is like any television show.
Right.
It's 3 to 4 months. But that's really for the actors. The writers sort of never get a break.
Right.
Nor the animators.
I'm going to ask Greg's question. Do you wake up every morning and just check your bank account? Because he said like he would do that. Like
Greg's obsessed.
He asked
with that.
Who'd you ask?
Mark Cuban.
Mark Cuban.
Yeah. I asked
does he?
Yeah, he does.
Yeah, he does.
Yes. Oh.
I said, when you wake up in the morning, is your very, very first thought, I'm a billionaire. And he said, you know what? It is.
It is.
And then when they said, hey, you know, Yeardley arrived a little bit early, I said, well, tell her to run out and buy an Aston Martin. Which is very tacky.
I have an Aston Martin.
Do you really?
Yeah, but I don't own it. I lease it.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Okay.
I just got it.
If it drives, flies, or Fs, you lease it. Everybody knows that, Greg.
That's right.
Yeah. Everybody knows that.
My actual question was going to be, you know, it used to be if you were a voice actor, you could kind of be almost anonymous, yet everybody knew who you were. But you do movies and TV, you know, City Slickers, Fresh Off the Boat.
But even still, like,
Big Bang Theory.
Dude, you did Mama's Family.
Right.
You did Mama's Family.
Mama's Family.
So do you have a favorite? Like, do you prefer one over the other?
You know, I'm sort of media ambivalent. I had a lot of, and the only reason I'm not on camera as much now is not because I don't want to be, but because I don't get the jobs. So, it bothered me for a really long time. I had a very hard time with that transition, which was a confluence of many things, I think. Show business was changing and blah, blah, blah. It doesn't really matter. But, and now I'm much more at peace with it. My first love is stage. I love the fly by the seat of your pants aspect of it. I love that you get on the train at the beginning of the show and you can't get off till the very end. If you find yourself in trouble in the middle of a scene, you better effing know how to get your way out. I like, and maybe because that's where I started, and I also feel like it really it's a skill. Whereas I think that you can do stage and then also translate or morph into television and film. I think it's much harder to go from film and then do stage. They really are different arts. It's not impossible, but I really do love that. I love the live interaction with the audience.
But even the voiceover thing seems to be more difficult now because it seems like there's just a lot of like big celebrities that are like Greg was talking about that because Greg had this ambition to be, I mean, you can hear he's got a silky voice.
He does.
Well,
mellifluous.
But nowadays,
but now it's just like John Krasinski gets everything.
Or John Hamm.
John Hamm gets
Jay
a lot
from Modern Family.
Yeah.
Can't think of his real name. Ed O'Neill.
Yeah.
He does everything.
Everything.
Well, yeah. That guy from The Office, he does a bunch too.
Yeah,
but people think it's easy and it's not.
Yeah. I think that's the, you know, when people ask me, like, what do you think about the celebrities doing voiceover? I said, look, it's the world that we live in. I'm actually not famous enough to get a leading role in an animated film.
How is that the case?
I know, that's impossible.
It's a funny double standard in our business, which I'm sure you all are internally familiar with,
yeah,
that the wide world might not be. And again, like, who cares? Whatever. You got to dance with the one that brung you, so figure it out, right? Mm-hmm. But the only exception I take to the idea that these celebrities should be and are doing voiceover is that there is this kind of like, I'm slumming it, as though voiceover is some sort of second tier in the acting world. Whereas just because nobody can see your face, I don't think it requires any less skill.
Agreed.
Or emotion or dedication to the job that you're doing. And so that's my only beef with it.
Yeah, because I mean, you still are. I mean, it's all, you have to really almost sell it more.
Yeah, you have to be, you know, totally invested in it.
I think,
yeah,
from like a radio standpoint, like Orson Welles, right, convinced everybody that aliens were landing.
Such
and,
a good point.
You know what I mean? Like, you have to paint all these pictures with words, and you have to really make people feel things without seeing a facial expression.
Right.
Without, yeah, I mean, they are, I guess, in an animated sense.
Well, they gotta trust the animators,
right? Yeah. But that's an animation. We're just in regular voice over there. I mean, look at I'm spacing a celebrity name. Mm-hmm. Shawshank Redemption, black guy.
Oh, Morgan Freeman.
Morgan Freeman.
Yeah, incredible.
Yeah. But like,
oh, he's the best.
Yeah.
There's so much heart and emotion when he's doing like a voiceover thing. You know?
I would just say I would, for myself, I don't take the job any less seriously just because you can't see my face.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
We're going to talk about Small Town Dicks. Now, this is a true crime podcast. Now, like, did you create this? Is this your baby?
I co-created it with my friend Zibby Allen and identical twin detectives Dan and Dave. So
okay,
we're
nice.
All four co-hosts of this true crime podcast. And all of our cases are told by the detectives who investigated them. And
oh,
the premise
cool.
is that big time crime is happening in small town USA everywhere with the same level of depravity and reckless disregard for human life as it is in big cities, but just with less frequency.
And with less resources, I would imagine, too, right?
Yeah. Exactly. So if you work for a small town agency, you will wear multiple hats.
Yeah.
You might be the major crimes detective, and there's only two of you because there's only nine detectives in the whole department. Mm-hmm. You might go to a welfare call where somebody says, I haven't seen my neighbor in 2 weeks. Can you go check it out? Then you find out, oh, my God, there's a person in there with a gun and it's pointed my way. Now you go back to the trunk of your car and you put on your SWAT vest and your helmet and you get your long rifle out. And now you're like, okay, I'm posting up to see what's next. And so, and they're expected to produce the same work product, the same level of excellence, the same ability to have all the pieces fall into place perfectly so that justice can be served as you have in big cities, but as you say, with many fewer resources.
Right. Well, you can find all the episodes. We're getting ready for season 4, which is going to be out this Friday. smalltowndicks.com. Make sure you type that in right. You might get a weird website otherwise. smalltowndicks.com for all the episodes. So, I mean, who brings you? I mean, do you guys do your own research? Like, or does somebody bring you, like, hey, I got this crazy case that you might have heard about? Like, do they bring you the cases?
We rely on Dan and Dave to go and find the cases for us and also to vet the people who are telling them. We really, really... Although it was not part of our mandate, one of the lovely sort of artifacts of this, things that has come out of this podcast, is that there's really exceptional police work being done everywhere. And while there is certainly a worthy conversation about also bad actors in police work, and we hear a lot about that in national news, there's really great work being done out there too. And these people care deeply about the investigations that they're spearheading, and all of them say it's a calling, it's not a job. And so, and as you know, as spectators, Zibby and I feel like I want the good guys to win. I want to know if we live in a world where people are willing to derail the train and create extraordinary chaos, that there's a force larger than me that can actually put that train back on the tracks.
Well, you are very small.
I am very
How
small.
Tall are you?
5'3".
Raby, how tall are you?
5 foot. On a good day. On a good
really?
Day.
Oh, okay.
On a day when I'm feeling extra upright.
I know what you mean.
Your laugh is even Lisa Simpson.
It is.
It is.
I'm telling you, we share a lot of traits. I love that girl.
Like over the course of that though, is it more your personality or you at a certain time in your life that you
I you know, Lisa Simpson is who I wish I were.
Yeah.
At every stage of my life.
Yeah.
She's who I wish I had been at 8. She's who I wish I were at 54. Yeah. She is one of the best, most fully realized, extraordinary, multifaceted characters ever created across all mediums.
Wow.
And it is really, it's an honor to be a part of her.
Yeah.
Agreed.
To live in her heart and mind.
Mm-hmm. Right. So the most interesting case that you guys have covered on Small Town Dicks on that podcast, which again, you can find all the episodes, smalltowndicks.com. Yeardley Smith is here and we're talking about this podcast. How long is each episode?
Each episode is somewhere between 40 minutes and an hour, usually. A couple are a bit shorter.
So is each episode one case, or do you take one case and break it up over multiple episodes?
Mostly they're standalone. We have
good.
A couple of two-parters.
Yeah.
We have one four-parter at the end of season one called The Sociopath and the Whistleblower, which is about a bad cop, and it's a fascinating case.
Yeah.
We have another two-parter called Presumed Guilty, where two people were put in prison for 12 years wrongly accused. But most of them are standalone, and it's just fascinating to hear about an investigation from soup to nuts, whereas on the news we hear, you know, 8% of what actually happened.
A lot of times,
you hear the capture.
I complain about this all the time, because we cover a lot of news on the show every day. Very rarely do you, unless it's a big high-profile case, you never get an update.
Zero.
No, that's it.
Yeah. That's
like,
true.
You never hear about how things turned out, or, you know, that person, you're like, oh my God, what an animal. Like, you never hear what sentence they got, never anything about them again.
And we go into all of that.
Yeah.
And we change all the names of our victims. We don't actually tell you where the crime took place. We don't give you the last name of the detectives, because really we don't want to re-traumatize the victims. And for us, it is about the great work that was done, and about how, again, like, all of the pieces have to fall into place in order for these things to come to fruition. So it's really good. And you can get it on Spotify, iTunes, Google, everywhere you like to listen.
Wherever you find podcasts. What was the most fascinating or the most shocking case that you guys covered on Small Town Dicks?
Gosh, I mean, that's like asking, you know, who's your favorite child?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
We did a case in season one called 10 Below, where they go to a welfare check because the suspect called 911 and said, I think I'm going to commit suicide. They arrive. He's in a drug-addled state. There are weapons all around him. They find a freezer in the garage. They open it up. There are two bodies in there.
Whoa.
His parents haven't been seen in
weeks.
Oh,
my God.
So put that together.
Yeah.
There's The Sociopath and the Whistleblower is a real flagship case for us. There's a great case called If These Walls Could Talk, where there's a man who they suspect of murdering his wife. There's a condition about like mumbling, sort of like narcolepsy, but mumbling. I forget what it's called.
Uh-huh.
So they actually get a search warrant to bug his house. They bug his house and they listen to him clean up the crime scene. And he's playing Gregorian chants in the background. And we actually have that recording.
Oh wow.
Whoa.
And it's fascinating. That's a great case.
Really, nightmares?
They're all amazing, I have to say. And we have a wonderful episode with one of the 911 dispatchers who in her small town is the one who fields these calls. We asked her to bring three memorable calls to tell us, you know, about those. And it's a really fantastic, diverse, eclectic bunch of stories.
Have you always been into like the crime story stuff?
Yes, although, you know, as a kid, again, I am like Lisa Simpson, where I'm like, who are these people who are willing to break the rules? And first it's playing hooky, right?
Yeah, yeah,
I never played hooky, never
in
my life. And then as you get older, God forbid, it morphs into, you know, shoplifting. And then if it
hurting
morphs
animals.
Yet further, you know, it's murder. And I just want to know, okay, if those people really don't value the things that the rest of us live by in order for society to function, please tell me that there is a force bigger than me that can make it all right. Mm-hmm. And so that's my kind of, oh yay, I like the good guys to win. I really do.
So it's not done in like a salacious way.
No, we really, it's a really good question, because it's such a razor's edge where crime now has become entertainment.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And for us,
exactly.
You know, we don't want to re-traumatize our victims, which is why we change all the names and locations. But there is also something to be learned from. And as women, we're often the victims.
Sure.
And so there's a kind of there, but for the grace of God go I. And if I was in that situation, what would I do? And maybe there's a takeaway of, okay, listen to me. don't walk down that dark alley.
Yeah.
Don't leave anything in your car.
Right.
Yeah. You know, don't be afraid to ask somebody to walk you to the car if it's late at night and you're at a bar. All of those things. And so, you know, we just really, it's about the case and the people who worked it. Who are you? Why do you do what you do? And how do you do it? These detectives.
I find it kind of annoying and frustrating. Some of these shows, like the Netflix ones, you know what I mean?
Right.
Where people
Making
get into
murder.
It as like it's The Bachelor.
Yeah.
Like, oh my God,
true.
Did you watch last night? It's the way that people end up talking about it. And I get being fascinated or interested by it, but like if you're not, I think, naturally disgusted by it, like that should be a red flag.
I think people have become so numb by it.
Right.
Yeah.
They have so much access to these stories now.
True.
And then, you know what, in talking about what you're saying about not walking a certain way or just being aware of your surroundings, like I watched that show First 48, and it's weird because that's an actual death. Somebody actually got murdered.
Those are real people, real lives.
Yeah, you're just watching it, and then there was like this one senseless, like, oh, this guy was, you know, invited some guy over through a dating app, and that guy noticed there was an iPad there, and he killed him for the iPad. Like.
Yeah.
You can't imagine.
Dude.
People die for a couple hundred bucks.
Yeah.
You know, they,
or less.
There we have a story. The very first episode we did actually called Don't Go is because this couple, they had been boyfriend and girlfriend. They broke up. They sort of reunited. This was, she was going to tell him, no, we're really not getting back together. They spent the night together. He saw a text message come in on her phone. It was from another man. Meanwhile, they were not together anymore. And he took a baseball bat to her head.
Oh.
And you just go, wow. I mean,
Like that's how it ends, you
that's
know?
Yeah, right.
Really
yeah.
crazy.
Yeah.
Well, the podcast is called Small Town Dicks. It's available wherever you find podcasts. You can also go to smalltowndicks.com. Season 4 is out this Friday.